The church's chicken. Good morning, beloved of the Lord. This is one heck of a statement to open a service of worship, and I hope that it grips your mind so that you follow through all the way. Our call to worship this morning comes to us from Psalm 28, reading verse 7. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him, and he helps me. My heart leaps for joy, and with my song I praise him. And with that, we enter into a time of prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we lord and honor your holy name, the name above all names, for it is only in the name of Jesus that we have hope. Jesus Christ, the King of heaven, enthroned in your kingdom, in light and splendor, we bow before you in humility and we worship you. Holy Spirit of God, pure power of love, alive in the souls of the saved, we submit ourselves to you and we prepare to bring our praise before you, our triune God, almighty and powerful, all-knowing and all-loving. Receive our prayers and our offering of worship. Immortal, invisible God, only wise, in light inaccessible, hid from our eyes. In the presence of your magnificence and glory, we shrink back, humbled and unsure of ourselves, for we stand now in the presence of the great Creator God, our ruler and our judge. Who is man that thou art mindful of him? And yet, Lord, here we are in your presence, and we are grateful. For it is only here that we find salvation, only here that we can be cleansed, only here that we can be filled with courage and love, only here that we have hope amidst a broken and troubled world. And so we confess our sins in all humility, shame and sorrow, for it is against you that we have sinned. The thorns, the nails, the spear are driven in by our hands through our sin. Forgive us, dear Lord Jesus, not because we deserve it or that we can justify it, but forgive us through the river of love that flowed on Calvary. Wash us and cleanse us and ask us to stand in your presence, for you have given us sonship in your kingdom. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And now fill us with your Holy Spirit, that our lives may be overflowing with joy and love, courage and strength, so that we may be equipped for the task that you are calling us to. We pray this in the name above all names, even the name of Jesus. Amen. Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And now we're going to sing what is fast becoming one of the most popular songs or hymns in modern Christian worship. In Christ Alone.
Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm.
What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving ceased.
My comforter, my all in all, pure in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save.
Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied.
For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness lay.
Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ.
No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny.
No power of hell, no scheme of man, can never pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, in Christ alone. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me,
our Old Testament lesson this morning comes to us from 2 Kings chapter 6 and reading verses 11 to 22. This is one of those chapters or passages of scripture that just captures my mind with the imagery. So I hope you get it as well. Reading from verse 11. The king of Aram was wanting to attack the king of Israel. But Elisha the prophet kept on telling the king of Israel what the king of Aram's plans were. And here we go, chapter 11. This enraged the king of Aram. He summoned his officers and demanded of them, "Tell me which of us is on the side of the king of Israel." "None of us, my lord the king," said one of his officers. "But Elisha, the prophet who is in Israel, tells the king of Israel every word you speak in your bedroom." "Go find out where he is," the king ordered, "so that I can send men and capture him." The report came back, "He is in Dothan." Then he sent horses and chariots and a strong force there. They went by night and surrounded the city. When the servant of the man of God got up and went out early the next morning, an army with horses and chariots had surrounded the city. "Oh no, my lord, what shall we do?" the servant asked.
"Don't be afraid," the prophet answered. "Those who are with us are more than those who are with them."
And Elisha prayed, "Open his eyes, Lord, that he may see." Then the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he looked, and he saw the hills full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. As the enemy came down towards him, Elisha prayed to the Lord, "Strike this army with blindness." So he struck them with blindness, and as Elisha had asked. Elisha told them, "This is not the road, and this is not the city. Follow me, and I will lead you to the man you are looking for." And he led them to Samaria. After they entered the city, Elisha said, "Lord, open the eyes of these men so they can see." Then the Lord opened their eyes, and they looked, and there they were inside Samaria. When the king of Israel saw them, he asked Elisha, "Shall I kill them, my father? Shall I kill them?" "Do not kill them," he answered. "Would you kill those you have captured with your own sword or bow? Set food and water before them so that they may eat and drink, and then go back to their master." So he prepared a great feast for them, and after they had finished eating and drinking, he sent them away, and they returned to their master. So the bands from Aram stopped raiding Israel's territory. Just so far our reading from the Old Testament this morning. Our second song this morning is one that really lays it out, tells us the truth. Jesus paid it all.
I hear the Savior say, "Thy strength in need is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all." Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. Jesus paid it all.
crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
And now we come to a short time of prayer. Let us pray. Lord of light and glory, open the eyes and hearts of your people as you opened the eyes of Elisha's servant. Hold us in the vision of your might and your power. Hold us in the vision of your glory and love. Prepare us now, Lord, for the proclamation of your word. And bless me to bring your people your message of honesty and hope. In your precious name we ask it, O Lord. Amen. And now we sing this wonderful song. They will know we are Christians by our love. And I wonder if you can make that rather personal and challenge yourself. Do they know that I am a Christian by my love? Here we are, let's sing.
We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. And we pray that our unity may one day be restored. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. Each other, we will walk hand in hand. We will walk with each other. We will walk hand in hand. And together we'll spread the news that God is in our land. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
To that. Our New Testament lesson is taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, just reading verses 16
to 18. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. Just so far, but we will be having a lot more scripture inside my sermon this morning. The church's chicken. Therefore, we do not lose heart, though outwardly we are wasting away. This amazing scripture was sent to me by the friend of a lady who is stage 4 cancer and of the liver, and it's possibly migrated now into the pelvic bones. She sent the scripture because she understands better than we do what these words mean. Therefore, we do not lose heart, though outwardly we are wasting away. But is that what Paul was referring to? Or is this something a little closer to home and the current state of affairs in the world? Paul was not yet in chains in Rome. He was in Macedonia writing his second letter to the church in Corinth. However, he and his co-workers knew hardship, persecution, and physical and mental challenges. To Paul, the enemy was the plethora of heathen gods, the immoral lives being led, and the tyranny of Rome. He was now on his third missionary journey in about the year AD 52, 5 years ahead of his first missionary journey. This was only 15 to 20 years after the death of Jesus. So the gospel, the Passover, the Pentecost, they were all very fresh in the memory, as was Paul's meeting with Jesus on the road to Damascus to arrest and, if necessary, kill the Christians there. Now a missionary for Christ, Paul was constantly being urged by his friends to take it easy, to think of yourself for a change. He had been beaten to within an inch of his life. He was always causing friction, be it with the Jews who refused to know Jesus or the pagans whose gods he was putting down. And always there was the threat of Rome. And Rome did not like the Jews, and they thought of the Christians as just a branch of Judaism. This was the context within which Paul was speaking. And just to put it into the context in our minds, this particular journey was well over 4,000 kilometers long, more than half of which he covered on foot. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. So here we have three scenarios I want to paint. The first is the woman who may be 60 or thereabouts, still with so much life ahead of her, a daughter's wedding, a first grandchild, another birthday, that longed for holiday of a lifetime. Though we are wasting away outwardly. Then we have the sick world and the COVID pandemic, that invasion into our lives and society that has caused sadness, frustration, loneliness, and death. And finally, we have the church, not Randburg Ridge United or any other denomination, but the church on earth. In the old language, we would talk about the church militant. So Our Lady with the cancer, alive, brain functioning, heart desiring, hoping, but aware of the reality. Outwardly, she's wasting away. She is now preparing her will getting her mind adjusted to hospice and many other farewells that need to be said. Yet this woman can say with Paul, "Yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day." Paul wrote something most valuable in Romans chapter 14, verse 8. He says, "If we live, we live for the Lord. And if we die, we die for the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord." Now that's courage, that's faith, that's conviction. I know that there are some of you who have turned in, I know that there are some of you who have tuned in who are in a similar position, or perhaps even worse. Your family have emigrated and you are alone and wondering what the future holds for you. This lady's faith has inspired and moved me. For many, this pandemic, added to the normal stresses, complaints, and complications of life, has made their lives a living hell. But there is good news. Just you wait and see. You know, that phrase reminds me of Vera Lynn in the middle of the Second World War. People wondering if it would ever end. Will they ever see their sons and fathers and boyfriends again? And Vera sings, "There'll be bluebirds over the white cliffs of Dover. Just you wait and see." I'm now going to switch to the second point. The current global condition that has suddenly been highlighted by the COVID pandemic. So to begin with, I want to read to you a few headlines and highlight some of the things that are going on that I've garnered off the internet from newspapers and the like around the world. Kim Davis was the state clerk of Rowan County, Kentucky, and she rose to fame or notoriety, depending on your view, when she refused a federal court order to register a same-sex marriage. Since then, she has been sued by a man for not letting her marry his computer, and she's been sued by a woman who refused to let her marry her dog. In an Illinois town, there is a shop called Tykeables. It's a shop where adults can go and dress in nappies and baby grows and lie in cots and suck their thumbs and dummies and pretend to be babies. A German committee has stated that incest is a fundamental right and sibling incest should be legal, says a Danish professor of criminal justice and ethics. Mother says that sex with her son is incredible as she reveals they're planning marriage and a baby. And Canada's top court has ruled that oral sex with animals is legal. At least one American state has made marriage to an animal legal. There's a woman who operates a brothel for animals where people can come and have sex with animals. And she says that the animals can consent. The United Nations, listen to this, people, listen to this. Taking kids to church violates their human rights, says the United Nations. They are pressing now for the sex age, the age of consent, to be reduced to 12. In California, it is possible for prostitutes to operate from the age of 12, and Turkey has lowered the age of consent to 12. And the Swedish Liberal Party youth wing has called for legalization of necrophilia incest. I mean, how sick. Pedophilia in America is now classed as a sexual orientation, not a crime. I'm sick. There's more, and I'm not going to read them because is just too horrifying. Now, regarding COVID, I'm not going to be drawn on whether this pandemic is man-made or not, but I do know that there are some very nefarious things happening. 5 African heads of state died mysteriously within 12 months of each other. And what do they have in common?
Each of them reviews the vaccine for their countries. And a sixth survived an assassination attempt. People are being turned away from shops and restaurants, travel and access to public places if they've not been able to present their vaccination certificate. In America, people are being offered $100 if they take the vaccine. The pressure is on to vaccinate the world for a disease that has a very high recovery rate. And if the vaccine actually did work, then we would have a cure for the common cold, for many of those viruses are also coronaviruses. I'm not trying to stir controversy or create a storm within the church. Please believe me when I say that. This is not my intention, but we have to admit that this virus, however caused, be it managed or not, has caused us to stop and think about many things. I'm hoping that our Christian beliefs is one of them. And so is the question, where to from here? Dear, dear friends, we are living in the saddest point in the history of the world. If it were not for our faith, we would need to be terrified. And even with our faith, we need to be hurting for the lost. You know, I've always been skeptical of the claims in the book of the Revelation of John regarding the mark of the beast. How on earth would the beast ever get it right to put a mark on every human being? I mean, surely we'd be able to duck that somehow or other. And if one did refuse, then of course we know what the restrictions would be. You wouldn't be able to get money, you wouldn't be able to spend your money, you wouldn't be able to buy food, you wouldn't be able to buy accommodation, etc., etc. How could they get that right? Well, sadly, for the first time in history, we now have the technology to do just that. Whether the powers that be or the powers behind the powers that be have planned the pandemic, or whether they are just taking advantage of it, the ability to mark every human being in the world with a mark is now possible, and they are trying it out in various countries, Malaysia and Europe among them. At very least, it has to make us think. So now we come to the Church of Jesus Christ in the world today, to the people known as little Christs, which is what Christians originally meant. The Americans have a saying that amuses me. They say, back in the day, without ever saying which day or period of time they're referring to. And it can mean different things to different generations. Back in the day to someone my age could refer to the 50s or 60s, but to my children it would be the 70s or 80s. But back in the day when governments in the Western world at least were influenced by the Christian Church and by the Holy Bible, when money was equal to gold and when society was free to walk in the streets without fear, back in that day, when faced with a pandemic like this, the folk flocked into church pleading to God Almighty to intervene. Folk who had not darkened the door of the church for years suddenly came to church to plead with God. So when I say that the church is chicken, I'm referring to its silence on the issues in society, from abortions to corruption to immorality to degeneration of morals that is now becoming institutionalized, lowering the age of consent to 12 years of age. What? And the church is silent. Humans marrying animals, a brothel for humans to have sexual intercourse with consenting animals. And the church is silent. We need each other. This is how God made us. We are called into fellowship with each other in the company of the Holy Spirit. Loneliness is killing people. I know of suicides that have taken place purely because of the loneliness. What is more, suicides in the 10 to 12 year olds is escalating at a frightening rate. Young children that are afraid of the future, so afraid that they're choosing to kill themselves. And the church is silent. And we who are Christians cannot serve our fellow human beings. Jesus said, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, so must you love one another. Jesus said, if you love me, you will obey my commands. And Jesus said, when the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit in his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to the owner's right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was ill, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you ill or in prison and go to visit you? The king will reply, truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these my brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. Beloved, in this time of unprecedented need, not only is the Christian church silent, but it has closed its doors. This is the saddest of times. Back now to Our Lady with cancer. So what does it mean when Paul says, inwardly we are being renewed day by day? In 2 Corinthians, Paul writes, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone, the new is here. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what's God's will. His good, pleasing, and perfect will, Romans 12:2. And then he says in Philippians 4:8, finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Christianity is not complicated, but it is difficult. That's a quote from Andy Stanley. May the reality of life and salvation become as real to us as it has become to our dear lady with cancer, so that we understand that although we and the world are sick and decaying on the outside, yet we who know and love Jesus are being renewed on the inside daily by faith. Now the good news for the world. The opposite of fear is faith. And Jesus said, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. John 14:27. And in Romans chapter 8, verse 15, the Spirit you receive does not make you slaves so that you live in fear. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship.
and by him we cry, Abba, Father. So, dear friends, being renewed inwardly day by day requires of us that we practice our faith without fear. This last message that I received via a friend from the cancer lady is this: so I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. As we work through this most challenging of times, may you and I be that strong in our faith that we can also say that we press on towards the goal that Jesus has called us to. And may the world's attempts to frighten us into submission not succeed. I speak with no authority from this church, not from its minister or its council. I speak with no authority of any denomination. So when I say what I have said, and when I say that what I'm about to say, I speak from the word of God and my own conscience. I believe that the church doors should remain open. Even if only 10 people arrive, they should have access to communal worship, to the table of our Lord, and to the means of grace. It is time to stand up and be counted. The end is nigh. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have so much to be grateful for. The sun rises in the morning and sets in the evening. The beauty of the birds and the wildlife and the flowers and the trees and the plants. And yet we are being separated from each other. Lord, give us wisdom. Give us courage, give us strength. And receive now, Lord, our gifts of love and faith. As we give to you our hearts, as we give to you that which we have managed to earn, that which we have in reserves, that your church may function, that your church may have the means by which it can operate. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for what we are able to get done. We thank you for this ministry, Lord, that we can get into our people's homes through this incredible technology. But Lord, how we yearn to be together, how we yearn for that fellowship. So Lord, in your name, in your wisdom, in your honor, and in your glory, we pray this prayer. Amen.
This next hymn is one that has so fallen out of favor in the church that I can't even find a modern version. But the church has become weak on its conviction. So here's the old hymn. One that I learned when I was 5 or 6. Onward, Christian soldiers.
And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, I wish you a wonderful week ahead, and enjoy the midweek services. It is such a wonderful thing to be able to keep in touch with the family through this technology. Now, I'm doing something different. We're going to have a song to sing out with, and it's one of great rejoicing. When we all get to heaven, enjoy it. You don't have to listen to it. The service is finished, but boy, oh boy, it's a wonderful thought when we all get to heaven.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, He'll prepare for us a place.
When we all
get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be.
When we all
see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sigh.
When we all
get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be.
When we all
see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of Him in glory will the toil of life repay.
When we all
get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be.
When we all
see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon His beauty we'll behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold.
When we all
get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be.
When we all
see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.